You guys asked for it, so let's do it. Let's take a look at all my Steadicam gear. Okay, let's not do it like that. Let's go through each item individually, one by one, and I'll talk about what I like about it, what I don't like about it, how I've modified the rig, and I'll even leave a link to every item in the description below. Some of those are gonna be affiliate links, but it doesn't cost you any additional money, just takes a little bit away from Jeff Bezos. So let's get started and check out the big things first. This is my Tiffen M1 sled, and I like it a lot. It is the gold mount version with the 1¾-inch post. I have the tilting top stage, but I don't really use it, and I wish I had the extra inch less height if I didn't get it. I have the Volt, and it works great. I would highly recommend it. If you want to learn more about the Volt, I made a whole video on that, and it's one of my favorites. My monitor is the 7-inch Transvideo Stargate. I would say it's okay. The picture is good and bright enough to be used in the sun. The internal level works great. However, the internal recording feature is just not very useful. I keep the mounting for the third battery on the bottom of the rig. I put my own stickers on the bottom as well. You'll soon see I went pretty crazy with the branding. I added this small level to the bottom that I use when balancing the rig. This 3D printed thing lets me dock in low mode with the standard Volt dock. It's by Jerry Holloway and I use it quite a bit and I think it's worth the money. I added this so I can mount a small action camera to my rig. It gives an interesting point of view that I use mostly for social media, and it's in a good spot that doesn't really get in the way. I added some small weights to the front because the monitor is a little bit too light and I wanted more space for dynamic balancing. They're also easy to remove if I'm adding weight in some other way. I wrapped the handle with some tennis racket grip tape. To me, this is a must-do or my sweaty hand will be sliding all over the place. I put a little hot glue underneath to keep it from sliding over time, and the burns from that little craft were worth it. I keep a low mode monitor on my rig, and this small HD is super bright and light, but I wish it had a recording function. To hold that on, I extended the rods that come with the rig to be longer. This was hard for me to find since the threading was not the ones the cheap rods use. Amazon had to take a lot of returns for that one. The actual mounting bit is from Tiffen, and I think it is perfect. Simple, flexible, but also really expensive. If I was doing it again, I think I would have used something else just to save the money. I keep it in the stock case. I wish the case was smaller, but I like that I don't have to break down the rig any to get it to fit. In there, I keep the stock Volt dock, even though I don't quite understand how it's supposed to fit in this space. I cut some spots to allow my add-ons to fit in the case. I keep the cables I know I will use in this space. The monitor cable, a 5-pin LeMo to 4-pin XLR I had made. One of these beautiful HDSDI BNC cables I had made. I'll talk more about them in a bit. The stock Volt cable, and the other Volt cable that I had made to be the exact length needed. I don't know why the stock ones have so much slack when none of the distances ever change. I also have this beauty. She's one of my favorite things, but I have had some problems with it, and she doesn't always do what you want her to. As for my arm, I have the G70X, which works great, and I would definitely recommend it. I put a wrap on it by Steady Sleeve, but please don't judge it based on how crappy mine looks. I've had this on for years, and the arm takes quite a beating. It's done a good job protecting the arm, and I like the way it looks. That brings us to my absolute favorite modification I've done. I keep the spin post by Camtech in the arm, and I love it. It lets the arm post spin completely freely, and it's one of the things I always thought was missing in the G70. I did have to sand down the docking pin a little to get it to hang on the pin. It wasn't a big deal if you put it in the chuck of a drill and hold some sandpaper to it for a while. I keep this in the stock bag that it comes with, but if I was going on a plane or something like that, I would get a hard case for it. For the vest, I use the Tiffen ExoVest. I love that it keeps me cool. I didn't do that many modifications to the vest, but I did add a way to mount an action camera to the back of my vest. It involved grinding a 15mm rod adapter wider because the rod is not 15mm. I don't know why anybody else would want to do this because it's really just for this YouTube channel.
Okay, so I admit this modification is kind of weird. I was doing an ad for Purple Mattresses on TikTok. I was getting sick of teenagers not making fun of my nose and I had to make a little bit of money. So, well, I'll just show it to you.
Soft, squishy, supportive. What can I do with this?
After some very serious testing in a real-world environment, it actually holds up to the weight. I'm thinking about neatening it up and leaving it in some spots.
And surprisingly, I did, but just in the positions right here. Now, I'm not suggesting you go out and change parts of your vest with a mattress, but don't feel like you need to keep it the way it is just because that's how it came. Feel free to switch things out.
I keep the vest in its stock case, and then I slide the arm into the vest. There's still a lot of room in there, so I also add a RoboCup, which I definitely recommend, and this click chair that folds up really small, and I love this thing too. On the case, I did change out the arm strap because it has a lot of weight now, and the stock one needs padding.
Now that stuff is obviously important, but if you can't dock and you can't balance, then you can't work.
These two cases are my stand and wheels. I keep the stand in a tripod case, and for the wheels, they go in a Tinba Cinelux 24, a really well-made case that is a bit overkill. I do recommend getting the large pneumatic tires. They make moving on rough ground a lot easier, but have their own problems as well. They are large, so moving in small spaces is harder, and they are pretty hard to turn. Underneath, I keep a shelf that I can attach to the bottom of my stand. I love having the shelf. It is great to have a place to put things that you may need quick access to. This is the innovative access system, and I like it a lot, even though it is crazy expensive. I also have the sandbag hooks that I thought were a stupid gimmick, but I now really like because the sandbag never slides off anymore. I also thought that having two wheels that could be either smart wheels or dumb wheels was a pointless feature that I would always keep as smart wheels, but after trying it out, I prefer to move the stand with the two dumb wheels most of the time. Depending on what surface you're on, it can take a lot of force to get the stand to move if they're all smart.
So we got that, but you're also gonna run into a lot of unusual builds, so you gotta solve those problems too.
This is my GAC case. It is a Pelican 1550, like most of my cases. I like them all to match to make packing easier. It's a great case for me, but I wish it was an air case to save that extra pound. Inside, I use the Trek Pack strips. I really like them because this case is constantly evolving, and the case is easy to modify along with it. This is my tool case, but I've already talked about everything I carry in this video, so I'll save some time. Ooh, free tape. Under that, I keep a 1/4-inch T-handle hex and a 7/64-inch T-hex. In this case, I keep an Insta360 and a bunch of batteries. I use this for getting BTS shots. They are really fun cameras and still work great, but are outdated, so check out the new ones. This case is another Insta360. This case holds my third battery adapter for the sled. I don't use it very much, but it's still pretty important to have. In this incorrectly labeled case, I keep my low mode monitor if I ever take it off the sled. I keep the dummy batteries to power it in there too, with the backup. This fancy bag holds the stickers that I give away. If you ever run into me when I'm working, I'll give you some if you're interested. I also keep this Fujifilm X100T. I use it mostly for Instagram photos of the rig, but at this point I think my phone is starting to beat it. Here is a whole bunch of power cables for different cameras that allow me to power the camera off the sled. They're great if I want to remove weight from the camera, and the battery is a lot of weight. This one I think is for the Alexa, but I can't remember which one is which without looking. The individual cables are great, but really expensive. So I would recommend getting one cable that is your sled power to a 4-pin XLR. Then with this plate, you can power any camera that uses a gold mount battery and save a lot of money. Get the V-mount one too, and you'll have a cable that'll do any camera. I keep a 3-pin LiMo to a PTAP splitter with the rod mount attachment. This I didn't realize was in here, it's supposed to be a different case. This cable is the Nucleus M power cable for the focus motors. Sometimes they go bad, so I like to have a backup in case the AC doesn't have one. A 3-pin LiMo to 2.1 right angle power. This is for a monitor that I have. These are all HDSDI BNC cables of various lengths. I always use the YCAM ones I had made. These are really beautiful cables that are super expensive. But I really bought them because I kind of think of them as an art piece. Just look at some of the detail on them. Some gaff tape I randomly threw in here one day, probably a year ago. This case holds my business cards, still good to have even in this tech world. This is my low mode bracket from Clean Camera Support. I like that the posts are interchangeable and I would definitely recommend it. This is the Airy Compact Bridge Plate Stabilizer Plate. I use it a lot and it saves me a lot of time mounting Alexa Mini LF to the sled. This is my SOS plate or Steady on Sticks, and I use this on most of the jobs that I do. It's an adapter that allows you to quickly move the camera to a tripod or anything else without having to remove the dovetail plate that's on your Steadicam. This is my alternative dovetail plate for the camera. This is a lot more flexible than the stock dovetail plate because I can extend it with rods to make it any length. I see a lot of people using the long dovetail plate in the same way that I use this one, but I prefer this one because it fits in my case a lot better. But I find that I prefer the stock dovetail plate to this one and don't use it as much as I thought I would. With this part and this mini case, I have this weird thing. It allows me to mount the Arri Alexa viewfinder to the back of the camera, normally on the back of the top handle. This balances the camera a lot better so it's not so side heavy, and still allows quick settings to be done. The DPs and ACs really love it. The rod part is so that I can put some pressure on a battery bracket if it's vibrating. I use the viewfinder adapter all the time, but I wish I got the other one available. This one tends to rotate since it has no locator pin and just one screw. I also never use the vibrating thing anymore because I don't really notice it a problem anymore. With this bracket, I can add some screw points to the bottom of an Alexa Mini and mount a dovetail directly to the camera. It works great, but I don't really use it much anymore. I've found that it takes too long to remove the part of the cage that the camera comes with to add this on. It works, but for a one-day job, it's not worth the additional time. This is my Alexa Classic case. And with these parts and the rotted dovetail plate, I can mount an Alexa Classic directly to the dovetail without a VTC plate. This saves a lot of weight and height, but I never use this anymore. I just don't run into Alexa Classics anymore. Also in there, I have this part that allows me to add a mounting point to the rods to also work with that system. I use it, but only on weird camera builds, but it does come in handy. This is a mount for a Teradek transmitter. It sandwiches between the battery and the battery mount, and I use this if I think the camera is too lightweight or if I want the camera build to be longer. These are two shark fins. One of them is gold mount and the other one is V mount. I have both, so it'll work with any camera build. It lets me add weight and length to any camera build by adding two batteries to the back of the camera instead of one. I grab for these before the Teradek mount because it is much faster to put on and take off, and it adds additional functionality to the camera build. The batteries are now hot swappable, so you don't need to power off the camera before changing the battery. I use them pretty often, but sometimes the camera kit already has one. In the top of the case, I have a lid organizer with a bunch of stuff crammed in there. So let's start with the 15mm rods. These are some cheap 6-inch rods, although the boys will tell you it's longer. These are the exact same thing, but they are titanium and about 10 times more expensive. They weigh about the same as the carbon fiber rods, but are strong as steel rods. If I'm being honest, I bought them because I thought they were cool, but I do still reach for them first because I know they don't flex. I also have a 9-inch set of the titanium. They show a little more of their value the longer they get, but it's still overkill. Two 6-inch aluminum threaded rods. I got these for free with something and I figured it was worth bringing in case of something. Two cheap 12-inch carbon fiber rods. These I bought for a specific job and they have come in handy a few times. They do flex though. An extendable rod selfie stick, really, for the Insta360 camera. I use this when I'm getting shots of myself for YouTube. The original 6-inch arm post that came with the G70X. I don't use this, but it's still good to have. A 12-inch arm post for my arm so I can get the camera really high up. Another 12-inch arm post to get the camera really high up. But this one is drilled so I can use it with my low mode bracket so I can also get the camera all the way to the ground. This is a standby bag. It's used to cover the camera and the sled if I'm going to lunch or if I'm going to be leaving the camera built in a studio overnight. It keeps the sun off of it so nothing overheats, as well as any accidental water that might get on it. I also like that people can't tell what it is when it's covered up, so no one wants to touch the rig when I'm not there. Highly recommend it. Even though I avoid using a radio at all costs, I bring my own surveillance kit just in case. I do recommend the on-set headsets. A headlamp I use all the time. You will definitely have to set up and strike in the dark, and looking like a dork is worth the extra hand. This is my backup volt kit. It has both the cables needed as well as some extra belts in it, even though you can literally hang from the belt. This case is full of BNC 90 degree angle adapters and barrels. This is way too many of them, but they do come up sometimes. A case of 1/4-20 and 3/8-16 mounting screws of all different lengths and washers. Very important. A P-tap to 2-pin LiMo that has a lot of uses, but is not supposed to be in this spot. Oops. A lens cleaning kit. Some mounting options I bought for a specific job, but keep with me because they are quite flexible. A cheap Israel arm that'll fix a lot of problems that you run into. I keep two of them, but I'm using one of them for the camera I'm shooting this with. I love these little sprigs. They push into any 1/4-20 hole and give you a small hook for cable management. I use them a lot because I don't like when things move on the camera, but they do get stolen a lot. Two of the short antennas for the Teradek. I like these more than the stock ones because they get in the way a lot less and don't move, but I don't use them that much because I normally leave that choice to the AC. These rod things that I specifically use for a VTC mount that I haven't gotten to yet. A bunch of Velcro will solve a lot of problems. And I keep one of these moisture absorbing packs that come with sneakers you're not supposed to eat.
I still can't power on the rig.
Inside another Pelican 1550, I keep 6 batteries. I found this is a good amount for jobs, as long as you have a way to charge them, and we'll keep up with that. The batteries are Gold Mount HyperCore Slims. I like them. They're batteries. Not a lot to say about that. A lot of people mention getting bigger batteries, like 150s for the back of the rig, but I think it's a bad idea. I find it hard to dynamic balance as it is with the lightweight monitor that I have on the other side. There's a charger to charge 4 at a time, and underneath I keep a power cable. It's also a good spot to hide stuff.
So I would call that my base kit. That's the stuff I have to have on every single job. But there's also a lot of stuff that I don't need on every job, but I like to have, so I just keep it in my car.
In this case, I have a Moses pole that works with the Volt. This is so a grip or a utility can carry around a staff that I can dock on. It's really great for tight spots or if we have to move through a crowd and I need to dock at the other side. That way the grip isn't just standing around holding the sled, pretending it's not getting slowly heavier and heavier. For me, the pole is about an inch too high, so I have to lift up on my tippy toes to dock each time. If I was to do it again, I would get the adjustable pole so that wasn't a problem. I keep two shop bags too. One I use for the stand, and the other I use for the cart or another stand. The sandbags work just as good, but I think the size difference is worth the extra cost. These are all 20-pound bags for comparison. I also keep this duffel bag full of safety gear and waterproofing. I did a whole video about waterproofing too, in case you're interested. This is the Jerry Hill poncho to put over me and the vest to keep me dry. And it has a small slit to allow the arm to get through. Really well made. A cover for the Volt, even though it's not intended for that. The arm covers, and most importantly, plastic wrap and a whole bunch of trash bags. Not water related, but I have this Matthews coupler for a round pipe. I use this as a spacer for the vehicle hard mount I haven't gotten to yet. This is a safety belt for tree climbers or something. I use it to harness my waist into something like a moving car. You can never have enough carabiners, but make sure they're real ones meant for climbing. These daisy chain strap things come in handy in the same situations. I also had some ratchet straps in here, but I guess I lost them on the last job.
So that's the stuff I bring with me to every location, but some stuff I don't, like my cart. I love having it, but it's not always appropriate to bring to a location that's maybe smaller, but let's talk about that.
This is my cart. It's the innovative Voyager 42 with the upgraded wheels. I like the cart a lot. It's strong and it folds down really small. The space inside is large enough to store all the parts, including the wheels, but I choose to keep the wheels in a separate case. It is really heavy if you keep it all together, and I have a hard time getting it into my car. I also have the Steadicam kit with it. It adds this baby pin mast that you can use to dock the rig, and also the pillow attached to it to keep the sled from bumping into the cart when you move it. And it includes this hanger for your vest. I also added this stand hanger, and it's nice to have. I would recommend the Steadicam kit for it, because it does add a significant amount of functionality to the cart.
Okay, great, now we got that. Now let's talk stuff that just isn't relevant for every job, like my live kit. Obviously, I only bring it for live shows.
This is my live kit, another 1550. This falls down every time, but I have no other place to put it. It is a dovetail plate that allows me to connect the camera that needs a VTC plate, but without the VTC. It saves a lot of weight, but it only works with Sony cameras. It would work with the Grass Valley cameras, but I don't want to put all my trust in this tiny latch and prefer to put a screw through here into the bottom of the camera. But the Grass Valleys don't have that. I know, I went a little crazy casing everything in here, but I didn't want to carry a bunch of smaller cases around. I also made a more in-depth video explaining the live kit too, if you want to find out more about everything. In this case, I have the G-Zoom that lets me control both zoom and focus on a broadcast lens, and it connects to the gimbal where my right hand holds. These are all the adapters needed for all the different lenses I may come in contact with. They allow me to control the zoom on any camera, and if the lens has an internal focus motor, I can tap into that as well. But not every lens has that capability, so I have this G-Focus box that can go in between the G-Zoom and an external focus motor that I haven't gotten to yet. And this is just boring mounting for the G-Focus. This is my backup for all of that, but it is a different foam layout, so I figured it was worth showing. This case holds the external motors that go with the G-Focus. One of them is a backup, and they both are exactly the same, but one has a different gear installed for now. I keep the mounting for everything underneath, and I keep various gears in here as well. In this case, I hold the Tri-X jumper. It is a much thinner cable than the normal Tri-X, so it doesn't interfere with the rig as much when I'm shooting with the camera tethered. This is really old technology now though, so I would just skip it unless you're running into those cameras still. But for whatever reason, I just hate taking things out of my kit. In this case, I keep my Simpty fiber jumper. It is the exact principle as the other jumper, but is what most cameras are using today. I also keep a backup underneath the padding because they are very delicate, although I haven't broken one yet. In this case, I keep the monitor I use for teleprompter. It has a bunch of BNC to 1/8 jacks in there. I bought to fix a problem I ran into once, but haven't gotten a try yet, so I would hold off on that. I also keep a standard HDMI cable in there that I haven't used yet, but may come up sometimes, I don't know. And the small cheese plate I use for mounting it. The power cable should be in here, but I found that in my GAC case. There's nothing special about this monitor. It's bright and light and cheap. It's just showing text, so it doesn't need to be fancy. This is an analog to SDI converter. For some reason, a lot of the return monitor transmitters are still analog, so I have to convert it to get the image to a modern monitor. And this is the power cables I need with that. These cases keep the tally sensor cables for the top stage that will light up to show when I'm live. They're exactly the same, just different brands. Hey, no case for these? Okay. These are the tally receivers that I velcroed to the top of my monitor, and they light up when the sensor sees that the tally has lit up. I looked all over the place to have these cables made, and no one would do it for me, so I ended up having to research how to make them myself. It was not so bad.
I'm not done.
I actually do have another stand as well. Sometimes on live shows, you may need to dock in different locations, and moving the stand is a pain. The only modification I did was to paint the locking mechanism orange with some nail polish so that I could visually see if the wheel was locked or not. Some benefits to this stand is it's a lot easier to move around on smooth surfaces, and you can also pack the whole thing, including the wheels, in a tripod case. Now let's talk about the twins. This is my X mount. It is a hard mount for vehicles or dollies. I like this one because it allows you to easily adjust the socket block with the rig already mounted to it. The negative is that it's bulky, so I don't bring it to every job, but I still think it's the best one. And this is the Mitchell mount, so I can attach it to things that have a Mitchell mount.
Almost done.
In this 1550, I have my AC kit. I used to bring this on a lot of jobs, but I tend not to anymore. This stuff is normally the AC's responsibility to bring to the job, and with that, they receive their own kit fee. So I don't feel comfortable renting it out anymore because I feel like it's stealing from the AC's. But this is a pretty good, relatively affordable kit, so let's talk about the main parts. This is a handheld unit for the Nucleus M, a wireless controller for focus, iris, and zoom, and this is the motor that connects to it. This kit is significantly cheaper than a lot of alternatives and works most of the time. This is the Teradek Bolt 500 transmitter and is used for sending wireless video to this director's monitor and is completely self-contained. That way, anyone can see the camera's video signal wirelessly and live, so they can either pull focus or yell at me to do the shot again, more level this time. Throw in some cheap gold mount batteries, and that's the most basic things a camera assistant would need.
Yes, we did it. Thanks so much for getting to the end of this video. And remember that all the links are in the description below. Thanks so much for watching. I really appreciate it. Give it a like if you liked it. And if you like this video, you'll probably like some of these other videos too.